This part of the course will be about simplification of Boolean functions. Remember that in the previous video, we saw examples for simplifying functions by algebraic manipulations. Nevertheless, we concluded that it is difficult to describe a general procedure for such manipulations. By Carnot maps, it is possible to put the simplification task into a systematic and, in fact, pictorial setting. A Carnot map is a tabular listing of the mean terms of a logic function, like that we have in a truth table. But this time, the table is arranged in a different way. Let me start introducing Carnot map in the simplest case, namely by considering functions of two variables. Literals of two variables can be combined in four different mean terms, which we can tabulate in a 2x2 map. Let us write these mean terms explicitly so that we can locate the different literals of two variables, say x and y, in the map. We can enumerate the rows for x and columns for y in this 2x2 map as 0 and 1. Any mean term number which can be between 0 and 3 can be directly obtained by simply combining the digit in its row with the digit in its column. Note that in this arrangement, all mean terms with unprimed x literal are in the second row, and those with x prime are in the first row. Similarly, the first and second columns contain the primed and unprimed literals of y, respectively. As the canonical sum of mean terms forms of Boolean functions, the Carnot maps too can be obtained directly from the truth tables. For example, x and y results in 1 only if both operands are 1. Therefore, the Carnot map of this function will look like this, and reveals that the AND operation consists of a single mean term, namely the third mean term. Note that the other squares correspond to the zeros of the function, but we omit these zeros for the sake of visual simplicity. On the other hand, the OR function will yield a 1 in 3 possible cases, that is, for x equals 1 and y equals 0, for y equals 1 and x equals 0, and for both equal 1. In other words, OR function is a sum of 3 mean terms, namely m1, m2, and m3. Obviously, the functions x and y, as well as x OR y, are already as simple as they can be. So, there is nothing to simplify in these functions. In order to appreciate the use of Carnot maps, we'd better to proceed to the three variable case. Let us now consider a function of three variables, namely x, y, and z. Since the number of possible mean terms in the function can be up to 8, we will use a 2x4 map. At this point, it is crucial to note that the enumeration of the columns which can be used to obtain the mean term numbers and the literals of the variables x, y, and z are done in a gray code sequence. They are 00, 01, 11, and 10 from left to right. In this arrangement, we again have all mean terms containing x prime in the first row, and those with x are in the second. On the other hand, the columns to the right of the map correspond to the mean terms with y in its unprimed form, whereas the columns on the left are four mean terms having y prime. Similarly, the mean terms in the middle contain z, and the mean terms on the rightmost and leftmost columns contain z prime. Using the 2-bit gray code in the columns of the map is the key point. Gray code has 1-bit difference between its adjacent symbols. Therefore, this arrangement assures that any adjacent squares in this map will correspond to mean terms that differ only in one literal. This is the case for squares which are touching each other horizontally as well as vertically. Consequently, the sum, well, strictly speaking, OR of any adjacent cells can be written so that the different variable in the cells is removed. For example, consider the cells in the middle of the second row containing x, y prime, z, and x, y, z. both cells are in the row we denote by X, and both are in the columns denoted by Z. So X and Z are the literals common to these minterms. The different literals are those of Y. Therefore, if the function has these minterms, that is, an expression like M5 or M7, we can use the distributive law and then drop the Y prime or Y factor. This simplifies these terms to the term XZ. In other words, Carnot maps facilitate easy recognition of such terms that can be simplified by dropping the different literals in them. Let me emphasize that using the gray code for the arrangement of the minterms in the map is crucial for having the minterms that differ only by one literal in adjacent cells. Now we can go over some examples for simplification of three-variable functions. The first function is x prime yz or x prime yz prime or x y prime z prime or x y prime z. You can try to simplify this function by algebraic manipulations, but locating the terms that can be simplified is much easier on a Carnot map. Here is our 2x4 map. The function is expressed as a sum of min terms, so we can directly transfer them to the table. For instance, the first term x prime yz is indicated by a 1 in the square that is in the first row, which contains all min terms with x prime, and in the third column that is marked by y as well as z. This is the third min term, and we see that the number of the corresponding square is coded, considering the first row, then the columns as 0, 1, 1, namely 3 in binary format. We see two adjacent pairs in this map. These two squares occupy the x row and the y prime columns. The literals of z are different in them, so we can simplify them to the term x y prime. Similarly, the other pair of adjacent cells are in the x prime row and y columns, again having their z literals different. They can be reduced to x prime y. You see, once you put down your Carnot map, obtaining a simplified form of the function is as easy as checking the common literals in the adjacent cells. This example is also a sum of four min terms. By noting the binary forms of their numbers, the min terms can be transferred to their cells in the map. Let us also mark the rows and columns containing the unprimed literals x, y, and z. Of course, the adjacency of min terms can show up also in a vertical manner, like in these two squares. Both squares are in the columns of y and z, and they differ in the x literal. So we can simplify them to a yz term. The remaining two cells seem not to be touching each other. Nevertheless, do not forget that the gray code is cyclic. In other words, the difference between the last and first symbols of a gray code sequence is also in one bit only. Therefore, these squares must be considered also as adjacent. In fact, both are in the x row and z prime columns. So they simplify to an xz prime term. As the last three variable example, consider x prime z or x prime y or x y prime z or yz. Note that here the first, second and last terms are not min terms. So the map will be prepared so that all min terms which are in these terms are checked in. For example, for the term x prime z, we put 1 into both squares that are in the x prime row and z column. We see that this function is a sum of 5 min terms. In this map, we can locate several different pairs, but these two pairs, in other words, 4 squares, occupy all columns that are marked as Z in full. The literals of X and Y appear in four different combinations in them. Therefore, we can reduce them to a single literal, that is z. This leaves us one more square. We can write it as an x prime y z prime term. But we can do better than this as far as the number of literals are concerned. We can consider this square together with the min term next to it and simplify it to a two literal term as x prime y. There is no harm in considering the same min term for two different terms since the resulting expression is a sum of products. We can summarize our experience in these examples in three rules of thumb. 1. Include all min terms of the function in the simplified expression. 2. Include none of the min terms which are not in the function. 3. Always seek for larger adjacency groups so as to reduce the number of literals in the simplified term. In fact, we can say that for an n-variable map, each square corresponds to a min term of n literals. Two adjacent squares then will result in a term of n minus 1 literals. By combining four squares together, you can write a term of n minus 2 literals. Generalizing along these lines, eight squares will correspond to a term of n minus 3 literals. On the other hand, if 2 to the n minus 1 squares, that is half of the complete map, can be combined together, you can obtain a single literal term. Of course, a function that contains 2 to the n, that means all possible min terms, is the identity function. In other words, identically equal to 1. Now, let's try to simplify a function of four variables. F of w, x, y, z, given with this expression. Since the number of min terms will be between 0 and 15, we need a 16 square map. We are going to organize it as 4 by 4. Again, checking the terms in the function to the min terms they contain and marking the w and x rows and y and z columns, we can get the Carnot map of this function. Note that not only the columns, but also the rows are enumerated in gray code order. Let us start with a pair of adjacent cells. In fact, considering the cyclic structure of the gray code, we realize that this pair is adjacent to the pair in the last row of the table. All these four squares are in the rows of x prime and columns of y prime. Therefore, we write x prime y prime term into the simplified function. Next, we can consider the cell in the bottom right corner. Again, this cell can be combined with the one in the upper right corner. Further, this pair is adjacent to the pair in the left corners. All these cells occupy the x prime rows and z prime columns. The literals of w and y occur in four different combinations in these min terms. So we reduce these corner cells to x prime, z prime. Finally, to include the remaining cell in the function, we can combine it with its own neighbor so as to eliminate the x literal and write a term of w prime, y, z prime. This example showed us that adjacencies for the squares at the edges of the map should be sought also at the opposite edges. In other words, we should visualize the map more like a flat open cylinder in the horizontal as well as in the vertical direction. The next challenge is a five-variable map. Consider this function, which is specified as a sum of min terms. Here we need a map of 32 cells. Let us organize it as 4 by 8. Again, I can't help emphasizing that 8 columns, which corresponds to the different combinations of literals of C, D, and E, are ordered according to a 3-bit gray code. As the number of variables is increasing, I would recommend to note the min term numbers in binary, so that they can be checked in the map easily. In this example 2, let me mark the rows that contains the minterms of unprimed A and unprimed B. Further, these are the columns of C, D, and E. Let us start with these four squares that fill out the intersection of B rows and C prime and E columns. But on the other side of the map, we have a similar group of four cells, which differ from these squares by the C literal in a pairwise way. So these eight squares occupy all cells in the intersection of B rows and E columns. Hence, they are simplified as BE. Similarly, we note that this pair has an adjacent counterpart in the other half of the map, and all these four squares are in the rows of A, columns of D prime, and columns of E. So they can be reduced to A, D prime, E. We recognize this square to be adjacent to this one by checking their column codes. They differ in their D literals. Further, the difference between this pair and the pair in the other side of the map is only in the C literals. Therefore, we can simplify them as a term of A prime, B prime, E prime. The moral of the story in this example is that we also have to check adjacencies by virtually folding the map in the middle as the number of variables grow. Since in a Carnot map, sums of min terms are written as simpler terms, simplification by this method seems to bound to yield a sum of products. How can we then obtain a function simplified as a product of sums? Since complementing one standard form results in the other standard form, a straightforward way of obtaining a product of sums is to first simplify f prime and then complement this result to obtain f. Let us study this method on an example. Consider a function given as a sum of the 0th, 1st, 2nd, 5th, 8th, 9th, and 10th min terms. The Carnot map then turns out to be as in this table. We denoted also the zeros explicitly in this map. Since f prime is 1 whenever f is 0, to obtain f prime in a simplified form, we need to group and reduce the cells marked by zeros. Here we have four cells that cover the full row of WX. Also, this column can be simplified as a YZ term. Finally, the remaining zeros on either sides of the map cover the intersection of the X rows and Z prime columns, and hence can be reduced as XZ prime. Complementing f prime in this form yield f as a product of sums. W prime or x prime and y prime or z prime and x prime or z. On the other hand, let us also write f as a sum of products from the Carnot map. Here we have x prime y prime term. The four corners reduce to x prime z prime. And the remaining cell can be combined with its neighbor into a W prime, Y prime, Z term. These expressions of F can be realized in two different circuit diagrams. To implement F from the product of sums form, we need primed literals of all four variables. So this bank of inverters will generate the primed literals. The sum which appear as the factors of F can be obtained by OR gates combining the relevant literals. Next, a 3-input AND gate can be used to generate the function f. If the implementation is based on the sum of products form, again, 4 inverters can be used for W prime, X prime, Y prime, and Z prime. Combinations of these literals can be passed through AND gates to realize the products. Finally, a multi-input OR gate is necessary to generate F at the output. Generally speaking, the inverters in these diagrams may be necessary depending on whether prime literals appear in the simplified expressions or not. So, regarding them as the zeroth level, the implementation from the product of sums form results in a two-level diagram, where the first level is a bank of OR gates, and the second level consists of a single multi-input AND gate. Such an implementation is called as OR AND implementation. In the realization obtained from a sum of products, the first level consists of AND gates, and the second level is a single OR gate. This implementation is known as AND-OR implementation. We conclude that any Boolean function can be implemented by the NOT, AND, and OR gates. We express this fact by saying that NOT, AND, and OR gates are functionally complete. There are also other possible functionally complete gate combinations. In fact, NAND gate as well as NOR gate is functionally complete by itself. To show this, it is sufficient to verify that NOT, AND, and OR gates can be implemented using NAND or NOR. First of all, note that 0 NAND 0 is 1. Also, 1 NAND 1 is 0. That means to implement a NOT operation using a NAND gate, we can simply connect the signal to be complemented to both inputs of a 2-input NAND gate. Then, AND operation between two variables is implemented by first NANDing them and then using another NAND gate to invert its output. Lastly, the OR operation, say X or Y, is equivalent to NANDing X prime and Y prime. This follows directly from De Morgan's rule. The complemented literals can be obtained by NAND gates as well. Functional completeness of NOR can be shown in a similar or rather dual way. I leave this to you as an exercise. It follows that an inverter can be implemented in three ways. The first one is the NOT gate we used to up to now. We can refer to such an implementation as buffer invert. An inverter can also be implemented by a NAND gate, where the variable to be complemented is connected to both inputs of the NAND gate. To simplify the drawing, we can use a NAND symbol with one input to express such an inverter. We shall call this as AND invert. Similarly, this symbol represents an inverter based on a NOR gate and is called as OR invert to distinguish it from the other two inverter implementations. So you can say that the small circles indicate a complementation wherever they are put. We can generalize this idea and use this NAND symbol, also called AND invert, and this invert OR symbol interchangeably because of De Morgan's rules. Proceeding in a dual way, a multi-input NOR operation can be implemented by a regular NOR gate, which you can also call OR invert, or by ANDing the inverted variables, in other words, as an invert AND operation. To sum up, completeness of NAND means, of course, that any function can be implemented using NAND gates. One way of achieving a NAND-only implementation is by replacing the NOT, AND, and OR gates of an AND-OR implementation with the equivalent NAND combinations. There is also a more direct way of obtaining NAND implementations. Let me show this on a generic example. We assume a logic function as XY or VW or Z. The number or combinations of variables here is not relevant. What we need is only that F is given in a sum of products form so that you can directly draw an AND-OR implementation of it. Once we have this AND-OR implementation, we can insert two inverters between the AND and OR levels. Let us show these inverters at the output of the AND gates and the input of the OR gate. For the line representing the single variable term, we denote one of the complementations as an AND invert operation. This augmentation transforms the first stage of AND gates to NAND. Also, the multi-input gate at the last stage represents now an invert OR operation. In other words, it is nothing but a NAND operation. So we have a circuit diagram for the function F composed of only NAND gates. This can also be verified by writing the algebraic expression this diagram represents and using De Morgan's rules. It follows that NAND implementations can be obtained directly by such a procedure. Express the function as a sum of products, NAND the literals of multiliteral terms and complement, that is AND invert, single literal terms. Combine the outputs of the first level with a single NAND gate. Here is an example, namely a function given as a sum of 0th and 6th min terms. The Carnot map of this function reveals that this sum of min terms is not simplifiable. X prime, Y prime, Z prime, or X, Y, Z prime is the simplest sum of products form of F. To obtain a NAND implementation, first use AND invert gates to obtain X prime, Y prime, and Z prime. Then we NAND the literals appearing in the products of F, namely X prime, Y prime, Z prime, and also X, Y, and Z prime. Lastly, the outputs of these NAND gates are combined with also a NAND gate. An alternative way could be starting with a simplified form of F prime, which can be written from the Carnot map as Z or X prime Y or XY prime. To implement F prime, we need X prime and Y prime literals. Again, we will combine the literals of the products with NAND gates, so X prime must be NANDed with Y and X must be NANDed with Y prime. Z, on the other hand, appears as a single literal. Therefore, it is complemented. Combining the outputs of these NAND gates with another NAND, we obtain F prime. F can be generated by a further complementation, of course, by a NAND gate. We see that direct implementation of F can be obtained in arranging NAND gates in two levels. An implementation based on a sum of products of F prime requires an additional AND invert to generate F. So it results in a three-level implementation. Depending on the terms in the function and its complement, one or the other of these realizations may turn out to be more preferable. Next, consider NOR implementation. We shall proceed as we did in driving NAND circuits, nevertheless in a dual format. That means we start with a product of sums. The implementation corresponding to this is an OR AND logic circuit. Again, we insert two complementations between the OR and AND levels. One of them at the output of the OR gate, the other one at the input of the AND gate. For single variables, we implement one of the inverters as an OR invert. Here we recognize the invert AND operation in the last stage as a NOR gate. You can show also algebraically that such a NOR of NORs yield the original product of sums. So we can describe these manipulations in a simple procedure. Express the function as a product of sums. NOR the literals of multiliteral terms and complement, that is OR invert single literal terms. Combine the outputs of the first level with a single NOR gate. Let us continue the previous example and derive NOR implementations for the function given as the sum of two min terms, namely the 0th and 6th min terms. To obtain F as a product of sums, we can simplify F prime on a Carnot map and then complement. This yields F as Z prime and X or Y prime and X prime or Y. After generating X prime and Y prime by NOR gates, we can NOR the literals appearing in the sums, namely X with Y prime and X prime with Y. Note that we do not need z prime, since z prime, being the single literal of the product, has to be complemented anyway. So we can combine the outputs of the first level of NOR gates with z to generate the function f. For the alternative way, that is implementing the function from f prime expressed as a product of sums, we can consider the sum of products form of f. So its complement will be a product of sums. In this case, one of the NOR gates in the first level will combine the literals x, y, z, whereas the other one x prime, y prime, and z. These outputs are NOR to yield f prime. The last NOR gate is used as an OR invert inverter. Similar to the NAND implementations, NOR circuits can result in two-level or three-level implementations depending on whether f or f prime is given as a product of sums. Up to now, we used four types of gates to combine the primed and unprimed literals of a function, namely AND, OR, NAND, NOR. Also, we consider two levels of these gates to generate either a function or its complement. In fact, four gates can be arranged in 16 different pairs for two-level implementations. However, some pairs cannot qualify for generating all possible Boolean functions. Such combinations are called degenerate forms. For example, the AND-AND form can effectively implement only a product, that is, a term of ANDed literals. Implementing a term of ORed literals is not possible by using only AND gates. Similarly, OR-OR combinations cannot generate any product terms. Also, OR-NOR does not offer much in that sense, because the difference from an OR-OR combination will be only that the output is inverted. By similar arguments, it is not difficult to conclude that these eight forms are degenerate. So that leaves us with eight non-degenerate forms, which can be used to generate any Boolean function. Indeed, up to now we saw how AND-OR, OR-AND, NAND-NAND, and NOR-NOR implementations can be obtained. Let's briefly review how the other four forms are related to these and to the standard forms. NAND-AND implementations are obtained by replacing the second level NAND gate of a NAND-NAND implementation with an AND gate. Effectively, this results in the complement of the function that is implemented by NAND-NAND arrangement. In other words, it corresponds to the complement of a sum of products. Further, by transferring the inverters at the outputs of the gates in the first level to the input of the second level, we see that NAND-AND and AND-NOR implementations are equivalent. The last two implementations are the duals of these. They are based on the product of sums form. NOR-OR generates the complement of NOR-NOR. In other words, the complement of a function given as a product of sums. Finally, moving the inverters attached to the gates in the first level to the input of the second level, it is seen that OR-NAND is equivalent to NOR-OR. Let us now resume our tour on Carnot maps and consider simplification under don't-care conditions. Sometimes there may be cases where the output of a logic circuit need not to be specified as a 0 or 1. For example, only 10 out of 16 possible 4-bit combinations are valid as a BCD symbol. Therefore, if the circuit is going to process only BCD symbols, one does not care what the output will be for the non-valid combinations. In general, such input combinations are referred to as don't care conditions, and they can be exploited for simplification purposes. For example, consider a function which is given as the sum of 5 minterms. We also denote the don't care combinations in a sum of minterms form, and we will show them on the map by capital X. The don't care conditions can be assumed to be either 0 or 1, according to whichever facilitates reduction to simpler expressions. In this example, we have a full column of 1s, which reduces 4 min terms to a y, z term. That leaves one more min term behind. By using the don't care condition of the fifth min term as a 1, we can cover this min term in a w prime z term. Let us also go for a product of some simplification. By considering the zeroth and second min terms as zeros of the function, we can express f prime as z prime or w y prime. This results in z and w prime or y for f, which is equivalent to what we obtained as a reduction to sum of products. Another example. We indicate the 0th, 1st, 2nd, 6th, and 14th min terms with 1 on the Carnot map. Again, the don't care conditions are shown by capital X. Considering the 10th min term as 1, we can simplify f to y z prime or w prime x prime y prime. On the other hand, for the simplification of f prime, we can consider all don't care conditions as 0 and reduce f prime to w x prime or y z or x y prime, which by complementing results in f equals w prime or x and y prime or z prime and x prime or y. Note that these two expressions are not equivalent in the strict sense. The former contains the 10th min term, whereas the latter does not. Nevertheless, one would expect that both can be used as a simplified form of f, because we don't care about the 10th min term. To finish this part, we have one more note about the Carnot maps. Obviously, in covering all min terms in the simplified expression, we would like to avoid redundant terms. To achieve this, it is important to understand two concepts about some special groups of cells. One of them is the prime implicant. A prime implicant is a term obtained by combining the maximum possible number of adjacent squares in a group. For example, in this map, the prime implicants are seen as groups of min terms that correspond to terms BD, AD, B prime C, CD, AB prime, and B prime D prime, all being groups of 4 cells. Moreover, if a min term in a group is covered by only one prime implicant, that prime implicant is an essential one. The essential prime implicants in this case are BD, since the fifth min term can only be covered by this prime implicant, and B prime D prime, since the zeroth min term can only be found in this group of cells. Since the zeroth and fifth min terms cannot be carried into the simplified expression in any other way, these essential prime implicants must be used in the function. Now, there are a couple of ways to take care of the other min terms. You can write them as CD or AD, or CD or AB prime, or B prime C or AD, or B prime C or AB prime. To sum up, in simplifying functions on a Carnot map, first determine the essential prime implicants, then find the minimum set of terms that covers the rest of the min terms. So now it's time to check your learning outcomes. In other words, that you can simplify Boolean functions to sum of products form and product of sums form, that you can realize Boolean functions in AND, OR AND, NAND, NAND, NOR, NOR forms as two or three level implementations that you can simplify Boolean functions with don't care conditions, and that you can determine the prime implicants or essential prime implicants of Boolean functions.